speaking that language, and I come from this place and speak this language. Or we can understand it like this. Aren't they all Galileans? Much like Jesus, isn't that Joseph's kid from Nazareth? Haven't we heard this tone in Scripture before? They're all Galileans? Surely God's not moving among them. Surely the Spirit's not empowering them. Surely these uneducated fishermen from the back sticks. Surely these half-educated men whose education boils down to 3 years on the road with an itinerant preacher that had no formal education of his own. Surely they are not the ones that God's gifting with the prophecies of old. Surely not. They're all Galileans, aren't they? Do you hear the racism in it? The judgment, the condemnation of others. Sure, the question might be honest. It might be sincere. It might even be a spiritual question at its core. But it's also just a wee bit racist. Compare and contrast for language, or people amazed that those people were people of God. Now, however we read it, however it was meant, the question remains, how did this happen? How did this happen, and what did it mean? And then we ask today, can it happen again? And please, can it happen here? Right? Please, can we have that same experience? Can we see our own burning bushes, each of us, hovering over our heads, so that we experience what those saints of old had, and our faith can be empowered and encouraged? The question still remains, how is it happening? And what does it mean? They're the same questions we ask today, aren't they? How is something that we see happening? Is it real? Is it a Photoshop faith moment? And what does it mean? I don't know about you, but I've asked these very questions about things I have seen in the larger community of faith around us. How is what I'm seeing happening? Is this a real thing? And what does it mean? I've asked it myself with faith healings. Is that real? Is that real, or am I being conned? Is it real, or is that an emotional response? Is that real, or are these actors playing a role for the betterment of the kingdom? Were they healed, or did they just think they were sick? Were the crutches given to them as they walked in the backstage, or were they slowly carried off in a whim of energy only to be re-handed their crutches and wheelchair behind the stage? Are these healings real? And if they are, what does it mean for me? What does it mean for my faith? I've asked questions like this myself. When I hear people talk about a near-death experience, I wonder, is that an emotional response? Is that a physiological response, or is that real? Is that real? And what does it mean for me? What does it mean about my faith? I've asked these questions with speaking in tongues, with our Pentecostal brothers and sisters. Is that real? Or is it just emotional exuberance? Is it just gibberish? Is it people showing off to try to look more spiritual than others? God knows the liberal church has got its own share of that too, right? Is that real? And if it is, what does that mean about my faith? What does that mean about my articulation of the Word of God? These questions, much like those witnesses at Pentecost, come from a place of curiosity. They do come from a place of curiosity, but it often is a judgmental curiosity. But curiosity nonetheless. These questions come from a place of reflection. Insecure reflection, but reflection nonetheless. I wonder if we are able to see the Spirit move. Are we able to see the Spirit move beyond our judgmental doubting? Could it really be moving among those people? Could it really be God at work in that place? Really? After all we've done, God's at work there in a way that we can't do? Are we able to see the Spirit move without fearful insecurity? Are we able to see the Spirit move without a fearful insecurity? What does it mean that I can't experience God like they do? What does it mean that I can't do what they do in an act of worship? What does that mean about me? And I will tell you that it can be a frightening thought. If there are faith healings, then shouldn't I be able to heal people? If there's a secret language of God, shouldn't I have learned it? And this is a dangerous train of thought. It's a dangerous train of thought, and it's not necessary. Paul reminds us in his letters to the church in Corinth and Ephesus, two easier to say names that Ken didn't get to read today, that there is one Spirit, but many gifts. One Spirit and many gifts, and not everyone needs the same gifts. Not everyone experiences God the same way. That we limit God when we try to limit God to our experience. Our experience of God is but a handle for us to hold on to the divine, to reach out and touch something that's bigger than we can understand. There are different gifts. Ones that we're very familiar with, and those that are so strange to us, that seem so strange. Do we have to understand something for it to be real? Do we have to experience something for it to be real? Do we have to believe something for it to be real? For ourselves or for others? If other Christians doubted the results of nonviolent resistance, if our more conservative brothers and sisters looked at the nonviolent resistance that marks some of our faith identity in our tradition, if they looked at it and scoffed and said, "I don't believe in that," I would point them the places in history that it has worked. I would point to the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ as a model of nonviolent resistance that has changed the world. And I would point to them the places that nonviolent resistance is working in the lives of people today as we call for and work for equality for all God's people. If other Christians doubted the importance of social justice, if they doubted the reality and the importance of social justice ministry, I would point to the places in history that the church has made a difference. I would point to the places in history where the church should have made a difference and we didn't. And I would point to the life and ministry and teachings of Jesus Christ. The way that he reached out for all people, that he broke down social constructs, where he challenged the norm on what was punishment and what was not, who was in and who was out. And I would point to the current work of the church today, giving dignity to all people. And it is working. As we call out for justice in the name of God with prophetic voice, and we are making a difference. Just because others don't believe in living out their faith the way we do does not mean our faith is not real. Just because others don't live out their faith the way we do doesn't mean the Spirit isn't moving among us. Just because others do not value the balance of faith and reason the way we do doesn't mean that our minds aren't bringing us close to God along with our hearts and experiences. Today we celebrate Pentecost. The birth of the church and the gift of the Spirit among us. And before we get too nostalgic, we need to remember, Jesus had already breathed the Spirit upon them in an upper room before this day ever happened. Jesus had told Peter, "You are the rock upon which I will build my church," before this ever happened. But on this day of Pentecost, the Spirit was moving. Something was happening. And on this public occasion, the Spirit moved. The Spirit was visible. And in response to the judgmental doubt, in response to the insecure questions, the church stood up in prophetic voice. The church stood up in proclamation, and the church speaks. We hear, "These men are not drunk." Translation: stop making excuses for your unwillingness to see. The church speaks up and says, "This is what the prophet Joel told you." Translation: this is the same God you have always known. Stop making excuses for what you don't understand, and know that this is the same God that you have always known. That's the response from the disciples. As we read on Acts, we get to hear how the crowd responds. This is the easier portion to read that Ken didn't get to read. "Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. And they said to Peter and the other apostles, 'What should we do?' And they told them, 'Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. Ask for forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, for your children, for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls. And they testified with other arguments and exhorted them, saying, save yourselves from this generation, so that you are welcome by this message and are baptized. And that about 3,000 persons were added to their community. They devoted themselves to the teachings, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to common prayer. This day of Pentecost had its strengths and its weaknesses. It had moments of racism and moments of judgment. Remember that even after this Pentecost, those first disciples struggled to see how this Spirit, this movement of God, could be for anyone except those of you from Judah and Jerusalem. The response is, you men of Judah and Jerusalem. Well, what about the ones from everywhere else? What about the ones who weren't Jewish? What about the Samaritans? The response of the apostles is not that much more inclusive at this point, but it is a sincere movement beyond what has been to something more. It is a widening of God's circle. It's not the end of it, it is a beginning. And the story gives us a reminder how we might begin our movement from one place to another, how we might respond to the Spirit's movement. First, we stop. We don't judge. We don't ignore. We stop and see what is happening. What is God doing in this time and place? What is God doing among us? We stop. And then we drop. We drop to our knees. We bow our heads. We lift our voices in humility to God and name what we see around us and what we see within us. We stop, we drop, and we grow. Some of you thought I was going to say roll, but that's for a different type of fire. We stop, we drop, and then we grow. We allow God to be bigger than we had imagined. We allow our eyes to see God in places we've never seen God before. In people, those people, even them, where we had yet to see God before. In our conservative brothers and sisters. In our Muslim brothers and sisters. In our atheist brothers and sisters. In those who are questioning and can't put words to it. And in those who've held the faith and fallen from grace. In all God's people, and yes, maybe even in us. We allow ourselves to see God at work, and we grow. We allow ourselves to see God bigger. And we allow God to call us into service in unfamiliar places and in new opportunities. We grow into service to God, accepting calls in unfamiliar places and in new places. We've seen this in our own church, haven't we? The Spirit was moving among other congregations and traditions. We saw God in people who looked different than us doing God's work. We saw God in people who sounded different than us in their language and traditions. We saw brothers and sisters in faith in those that others might exclude. We grew. We grew and we made Emmaus and Good Shepherd congregations into one. And today, Covina Community Church stands as a testimony. We grew and we welcomed in members from Covina Christian Church in need of a home. We grew. We grew. And we have seen this in our own church. The Spirit was moving among other congregations, other denominations. We saw people with different worshiping backgrounds, different theological backgrounds doing God's work. We saw that they were sincere and they needed a home to make that ministry grow. And so we extended our hospitality. We grew our hospitality gifts in this place. So now there are four congregations that worship on this holy ground, none of which have the same beliefs, perspective, but we all claim one God and are shaped by one Spirit. We grew. We have seen this at work in our own church. The Spirit was moving among women. We saw the powerful ministry women were doing. We heard God speaking through the testimony of women, and we grew to officially ordain women 165 years ago. Because we saw the Spirit moving when some others were still saying, I think they're drunk. I think they're crazy. I think they're witches. No, we said, no, that's the Spirit of God. We can't deny it. And we have to grow beyond our patriarchal male control issues and proclaim what God is doing. And so we did. And we grew. And we have seen this happen in our own church. A spirit moving among us as others excluded. We saw that people of all genders and gender identity were doing the good works of God. We saw the beauty of the Creator, the image of God, Imago Dei, in every person. And instead of condemning, we grew and made room in our hearts for others who challenged our perspective on society, for others who challenged our understanding of how relationship works, and we grew in our understanding of love. We grew in our understanding of love and what it means to be created in the image of God. And we said that the table of God is open to all people. The love of God comes to all people. And the work of God comes through all people. And today we are a place where all are welcome. And all means all. All. And we will see our church grow again in the days to come. Now, that may be one that some of you balk against. That may be one some of you struggle with. Pastor, we're watching churches shrink. We're watching churches sell. We're watching churches close. We're watching membership shrink. We're watching ourselves age out of our heyday. But we will see our own church grow in the days to come. The Spirit will move among us. We will see God at work. We will see lives change, and we will grow in ways we've yet to imagine. If we will stop and see God among us, see God at work in the world around us, if we will drop down to our knees and humbly ask God to guide us in new directions, to grow us in ways we've yet imagined, others will think we're drunk. Others will call us crazy, but we will be Spirit-led. We will have the courage to stop and see what God is doing. We will have the humility to pray our way through challenges, and we will grow. We will grow. Say it with me. We